All right. So let's get started. Welcome. My name is Erwin from the Koogh, founder of Bitgenix, a sort of technical startup. If you've been to any of my previous talks or have seen some of them online, this is not going to be like any of them. This is an impromptu talk. Naresh asked me to do, but this is going to be a whole bunch of stories around a piece of work that I did. I think it was sort of 2012, and it's basically some of the sort of biggest career highs and definitely some of the sort of career lows around a product that I helped build in a big telco, and all of the amazing things that we've done. And how ultimately we completely failed at delivering anything of value. And there's probably some sort of lessons in there to learn. So to start things off, I have both a very technical background and a very agile background. And was one of the reasons why I was asked by a big telco to join what they call their strategic innovation team. And we were working on, it was a telco, and basically our job, the small team that we had a team of about, sort of, but when we started there was about 6-7 people, grew to about sort of 10, but our job was to reimagine the way media is consumed, period. That was it. Reimagine how media is going to be consumed. And we were talking about TV, but also about movies, about series, about video on demand, and then sort of that sort of took a life of its own, and we built an insanely amazing product with that small group of people. So having both that technical background, Lean Startup had just come out a couple months before. And I was sort of really excited to start sort of putting these practices into sort of practice. Do Lean Startup for real in a massive massive telco with millions of customers. So this was extremely exciting stuff for me. The other thing is I was going to be responsible for the sort of all of the technical aspects of this amazing new thing that was basically going to be built from scratch. So extremely excited when I got started on this. And together, the team that we had was an interesting one. We had the guy who ran strategic innovation was someone who had years and years of telco experience. Right. Absolutely years in telco experience, knew the domain very well. We had a project manager who had been in the business for a long time that I knew very well, very capable, very personal project manager. There's very few good project managers in my book. He's definitely one of those people that sort of allows you sort of gets motivates teams to actually get stuff done, but then sort of takes away a lot of that sort of bureaucracy. A really good PM. And some other people who were product managers, product designers, UX researchers, that were some of the best I've worked with. So the first thing that we did when we had a thorny problem, like reimagine the way media is consumed, was user interviews. We went out to stores, we met with customers, our current customers, and we talked not about what they would want. That's not how we get started. Like, don't ask your customers what they want. But we started asking questions around sort of how they can currently consume media. When did they watch TV? When did they buy video on demand? Did they have any subscriptions to sort of Netflix and sort of other services out there? What did they download? So don't sort of start out. If you're starting this out with these sort of unknown, massively unknown problem, the trick wasn't to sort of start out asking what people want, because people never know what they want. people, the only thing people can tell you is that they don't want that after you showed them something. Yeah, that's the only thing you can get out of human beings reliably. We started talking. And then sort of when we had a whole bunch of these data, when we had a bunch of these conversations, we started to sort of see patterns. You start to see patterns. This and that, and sort of how does that work? And that's where we sort of identified potential pain points. We identified potential pain points. And started forming some of these hypotheses around that. And then we went back and talked to more people. Talked to more people. Does this sort of look familiar to you? And one of the things that stood out for us was there's so much stuff to watch. Like, what am I going to watch? Well, turns out people, they come home from work, or the kids are in bed, and I have an hour. People ended up watching some shitty stuff, whatever was on right now, because they couldn't be bothered trying to figure out what to watch. So they watched whatever, like the first thing that wasn't sort of terrible was the thing they ended up watching. So we didn't ask people what their problem was. We observed how they were doing this, asked what they were doing, and then we identified a particular pain point. And that resonated a lot with our customers. That, yeah, they never really watched anything really, really good. They just watched whatever was on the TV. So that got us to that first stage, sort of finding that problem. Yeah. And there were more, but that was sort of the big problem that we sort of latched onto. The next, and then sort of we took that up to that next level, right? If this is a problem, what are some of the solutions to that? What's the solution to this particular problem where we always end up watching something crappy because we can't be bothered looking up something? And that's when we had a lot of brainstorming and sort of talking and sort of within our group to sort of have a sort of have that sort of conversations around. How are we going to fix that? What do we think we can do? Yeah. And one of the bigger things that we sort of realized is wasn't a feature. It wasn't we're going to build this thing. But again, it was this really big high level sort of we need to split the looking up and the finding out about things. And the actual watching. Oh, by the way, if there's any questions, pop up, right? Like, this is about as free form as it's going to get. Is that a question? Because you're standing right in front of a lamp. this was like, I think it was 2012. I had to sort of go back, but it was sort of late 2012, late 2011, like early 2012, I think this was. Yeah, a couple years ago. That's sort of where we were at, right? It's the we're still not talking features. We're still talking sort of very high level. What can we do? Right? So the first thing we realized is the behavior that we want to see, that the change in behavior that we wanted to see was that people that we were going to split those two things. We're going to split out the looking up, the knowing about things to watch, and we need to make it really easy for people to sort of save and keep track of things they're interested in. You would be at work, and someone would say, "Have you seen that that new series that was just released?" And you're like, "No, I haven't heard of it." And you could easily go, "Oh, I'll sort of save this." Yeah. And if a new episode would come around, it would automatically be added. We could do a bunch of recommendations. So without going into very, very high level features, this is the behavior change we wanted to see. And then only then did we start to think about features. Only then did we start to think about, well, what features would this thing need to have? So first, we spend a whole lot of time talking about the different features, the different problems, finding out about the problems. Once we found out about the problem, it was very much confirming that problem. After that, that sort of that high level, what's the behavior we want to see, and only then did we get into that sort of more feature-based thinking. And the first thing to do there, after we had done all of that, was around prototyping. Guys, he's trying to get your attention. when we got the features, right? We were making paper prototypes. Yeah. Paper prototypes. One of the sort of UX researchers were doing quick sort of prototypes on paper, showing them to customers. This is what the screen would look like. What would A be? What would you do? And if they sort of pressed a button, and pressing a button was sort of pushing on the paper, right? We would show them the new piece of paper. Well, this is what the next screen would look like. Very, very low fidelity, because they were just pieces of A4 with lines and scribbles on them. But they were enough to get some really good feedback from those set of customers. Let's get some feedback. The flow was confusing and it didn't make any sense. And we could reduce steps and sort of change the way things were called and sort of labeled. So with that really low fidelity, literally minutes, and this was sort of like we were talking minutes worth of work, right? Not just sort of hours or days. A lot of these mock-ups were done in sort of minutes worth of work. And that sort of, and we progressed in that fashion. So after that paper prototype, we started doing HTML mock-ups. So people could actually sort of click through it. Still didn't do anything, still very much. And this was like it's a good question. Like we're talking sort of certainly tools-wise, this was sort of back in 2012. To do that sort of stuff now, there's a whole series of tools out there that makes this very easy for you. The one I've seen used since is a tool called Pop, but there's many more of it where you can sort of you can very quickly take photos of a wireframe of something you drew, and then say if they click on they click on this particular area of the screen, go to that that one right now. Right? So there's a lot of tools that will make this easier for you that we didn't have back then. But get that. Certainly, if you're building these very user-centric applications, go out with the lowest fidelity thing, and start having conversations with your potential customers. Find potential customers, have a chat, walk through what you're suggesting. So we went from paper prototypes, HTML prototypes, and this is where things got interesting. We had great feedback along the way. People absolutely loved the product. They loved the things that we were doing with it. And everyone was very enthusiastic about it. And that's where we made a relatively big investment, because remember, right now we're talking sort of investment of days. And then we spent a couple of weeks building a prototype. And this was a set-top box that had to fit under people's TV for literally like sort of tens of dollars. But we sort of took off-the-shelf components. We sort of started out with a Mac Mini, and we had a bunch of software, and we cobbled together a working prototype. Like it wasn't a toy. It wasn't anymore that the this is sort of, if you click here, you get another static page, but this was actually working stuff. Yeah. It wasn't ready to go into production, right? Because it was, the hardware was too expensive, the server would collapse. if sort of more than 10 people would use the thing at the same time. So it definitely wasn't production ready, but it gave us, again, a tremendous amount of feedback, because now we could observe people using the system, using our product. Has anyone ever been in a user session where you have seen people use your stuff? Like, it is the most humiliating thing you can do. Who was talking about it? I think it was it Jess to talk about it on Monday? I'm not sure. But you're literally sort of shouting at your users, like it, hopefully inside your head. There! Submit button's right there! Red! Pick it! Or yeah, like you ask people to go, could she go into the configuration and change this setting? Like, ask them to accomplish things. Don't tell them what to do. Go, so we would go, watch this particular movie. Change this setting. And people would, like, especially that one, I remember that as it was yesterday. So I'm sitting there with a user. They go, so change this particular setting. And they spent 2 minutes looking at the screen, and I'm like, 2 minutes is a long time, right? If you're observing people for 2 minutes, that's an eternity. And they're like, and you ask them to sort of vocalize sort of what they're thinking, and my God, I can't find where would the settings be? Where would the settings be? And they sort of go over the entire thing, and I'm like, there's a gear I could right there. Look, there's a gear. Can't find it. Fine. So one of the most humbling and humiliating things at the same time is observing actual users using your beautifully designed, carefully crafted stuff and just failing miserably at it. And again, that's extremely valuable feedback. Extremely valuable feedback. To use, because apparently a gear icon only works for Mac people, which is what all of us sort of designers and IT people were using. It didn't work for people that were using Windows, because that wasn't the icon for settings. And it's that those little things that make a tremendous difference in how people perceive the quality of your product. Tiny, tiny things. But even more fun, when we had this working prototype, was that we could now observe people using it in real time. We could get this into sort of living rooms. We installed it in a couple living rooms and sort of see what people would do with it and get some actual data. And there's some hilarious stuff that came out of that. Yeah. Because the other thing is we could now test new ideas. We could test new ideas. So one of these ideas, one of the execs, we had an iPhone app, but the execs went, we need to be able to control the TV not with a remote, but with your phone, your smartphone. And we went, that doesn't sound like a great idea. But we went, well, let's give it a shot. We've got this prototype. We can add stuff to it, we can remove stuff to it. So we spent a couple days and we built the remote, but we had a problem. One of the problems was, is if you had multiple screens in the house, you couldn't figure out which TV you were controlling. So what we did is we built a, before you got into remote control, what we did is we showed pictures of what was on the different screens in your house, and then you could select the right TV to then control. And so we built that functionality, and we released that, and we to the people that were using it, and to our user focus groups, and no one liked it. No one liked it, except for one demographic. One demographic loved this particular feature of using the remote control. But here's the interesting thing. They never got past the selection screen. So they were using the remote, but not actually the remote control. So we started talking to these people. I'm like, what's going on? I'm like, what, this new feature, what do you think of it? And I'm like, it's amazing. It's fantastic. It's fantastic. These were the people that had teenage kids, and they could now, on their phone, see what they were watching in their room. Right? So we very, very quickly killed the remote control. Right? Because that was useless. No one wanted the remote control. That was pointless. But what we did was had a parental control. You can see what the different screens in the house are showing. And through many of those iterations, we built literally an amazing product, right? It's 5 years on, and there's still nothing really on the market that sort of does what we were trying to do. Like Apple TV, the new Apple TV is great, but even then, I certainly think that we had some amazing things that sort of aren't properly done in there yet. Certainly to the sort of the breadth of media that you could sort of have. So it's an amazing product. Everyone loved it. Everyone loved it. The customers loved it. The sort of employees of the company loved it. The board loved it. And sort of so everyone thought this was an amazing thing and we should build it. But as you can sort of guess, with this being a postmortem, there's none of these things. Yep. None of them were ever manufactured. None of them were ever built. Certainly none were ever sold. And this is sort of where another whole bunch of learnings came from. Because the biggest mistake that we made was that we, at no point in time, had a go-to-market strategy. It wasn't our job to be very defensive for a bit. It wasn't our job. Our job was just to figure out what the product should look like, not to actually build. And that's what I see in a lot of these sort of labs. Like banks are very popular now. They have sort of labs type situations where we try to figure out what to build. And we were in exactly that situation. Our job was to figure out what to build, and then we would hand it over to IT, and they would do the actual building of the thing. And that model does not work at all. Has absolutely no chance of success for a bunch of reasons. The first one is that real IT, the IT people over there, have very, very different KPIs. These were the people that had to supply TV to millions of customers. To do the kind of stuff that we were suggesting would be enormously disruptive to what they were doing. So they didn't want any change. They didn't want any change because that would only increase the risk of their service going down, and that would be hard. And the other thing is, this was a massive piece of work. So even though we had board level approval for this. The other thing is they had millions of requests coming in. They had feature enhancement for their current stuff, they had feature enhancement for their next bits, and then they had this really vague, built this massively different thing. And all of them were high priority, of course. All of them had to be done yesterday. They built, quite rightly so, they built the things that were predictable and understandable, not the things that were actually disruptive. So that was one of a major problem that we encountered very relatively early that we were trying to overcome. Then the next bit was that even if we could have overcome that, the financials didn't add up. Our financials didn't add up in that the proposal that we were having would require a whole bunch of capital investment. The boxes that we would send out to our, we would have to sort of recall all of the setup boxes and send them new expensive ones. Now, our research more than suggested that people would want to pay for this. Like, people would be more than happy to pay for a new box. But the way the financial structure was, the finances were structured, made it almost impossible for the company to make big capital investments, even if they could recoup that money. Lastly, there's this sort of big brand reputation that people were afraid of. It's we're a big, serious sort of telco. We're the biggest in the country. So what we're gonna we can't risk having an outage. We just can't risk it. We can't risk delivering something that people would not want. And this is where a lot of that sort of what I mentioned is our go-to-market. We had no go-to-market strategy, A, because we weren't asked to give one. But even if we did, it would have been very, very hard. I talk a lot about how organizations can't make small decisions. Big organizations can't make small decisions. So for them, it was almost impossible to do this in the small. They couldn't go, well, we'll just sort of build 100 of these things or 1,000 of these things. And then we'll give them out, sell them, because that would A, be brand weird for their brand, because some people get, some people don't, it would be too expensive. And that's sort of where things started falling apart very, very quickly. And so the most important thing we tried to do there and even felt there is the thing we're trying to do sort of get around this is launch in one of their smaller brands. Because they had numerous brands. They had their big important one, and they had a couple of smaller ones. And unfortunately, that almost succeeded. But that failed as well. So looking back to that particular project, that particular gig, we did some things extremely well. Like, extremely well. The product that we built was of immense quality. People were interested in it. We knew people were willing to pay for it. We didn't. We very, very certain people were willing to pay a massive premium on it. But we had no go-to-market strategy. And I think that's most important. If you're in these sort of big organizations, in these market hubs, and I've seen this over and over at other clients and people I know who are in these hubs, is that just figuring out to build is only a tiny part of the problem. There's no chance of you succeeding if you do not have a strategy to go to market. One of the first things we should have done, and we didn't, is figure out how we are going to take this to the market. Were we going to do that? And the other thing is that handover just can't work. You can't just hand over a massively new product to IT for them to rebuild whatever they're doing right now. So if you're in these situations, you have to be able to build out your capability to do this for real and have a market to go-to-market strategy that allows you to test in the market. You have to figure out what are the financials that are associated with this? Can we actually afford this? The other thing you need to be careful is, well, how are we going to mitigate brand reputation? damage. Right? How are we going to mitigate the risk to brand damage? And how are we going to do that? Who's going to build it? How are we going to do it? IT's not going to build it. Your main brand is probably not going to risk it. Find a small brand, start working with them, secure enough funding to go out to your market, and continue testing there. Yeah? Any questions? We've got plenty of time, I think. Yeah, come on. Good 10 minutes of questions left. Are there any questions around sort of how we did some of the user research or some of the problems we were having with our go-to-market? Mm-hmm. So the question was, how are we protecting R&D from our competitors? We weren't. The thing is, ideas are useless. Ideas are pointless. Right? As we figured out, right? We had the idea, we had all the knowledge about the idea, and we still couldn't execute. Right? Ideas are cheap. There's a really cool example that drove this home to me, where on a conference, I was on a conference. And I can't remember who it was, but it was a massively sort of big important investor, right? Someone who invests in sort of tens of companies, made millions in the process. And to sort of reiterate that point, he sort of had up an envelope. He held up an envelope, and he goes, "Here's a $1 billion idea. Yeah. If you do this, right, you can build a $1 billion company." With it. And he was trying to sell it for $20,000. Would you? Would you have bought a $1 billion ID for $20,000? How much do you think he sold it for in the end? $20. He sold it for $20. Because someone wanted to sort of, it was fun. Someone was curious what the idea was. Like, we all know he didn't execute on the idea. So having these ideas, it's great, but it's useless. Right? If you don't have the capacity to back that up and actually do something with it, it's fine. We hear a lot about these startups and they're in stealth mode and there's what was it? There was a company. Transmeta, the company of the company that Linus Torvalds, the creator of Linux, sort of was working with, and they were building a new revolutionary chip, and they were in stealth mode for years. Everyone knew he was working on something exciting, and because this was Linux. And then years later, millions and millions and millions of dollars later, they've launched massive launch party. And absolutely nothing happened. Nothing. No one was even remotely interested in this stuff. So ideas are cheap. Don't worry about protecting your ideas from everyone else. Sure. Sort of legal made us sign NDAs with these people, but really, how are we ever going to enforce any of that stuff? You weren't. Right? If someone wants to leak this to a competitor, they are, and you're never going to find out. So we made them sign NDAs because that was the legal department did. We could have, but even we didn't. Right? We talked about it, and here's the funny thing. Because the funny thing was, after that thing was camped, all people that worked on that thing left the company. basically. One of the most demoralizing things I've done in my career. Spent a year and a half building something absolutely amazing, and then just go, someone's going, yeah, no, we're not going to do that. Yeah. So we all left. I was an external consultant. Even the employees all quit. And there was talk of, shall we just take this to market? Yeah, we had all the knowledge. And even we went, it's a bit risky. Do we really want to do that? So having all that information is extremely valuable if your intent is to go to market with it. But we could, and actually there's one guy that actually tried to sell it. There was a bit of interest, but even that didn't go anywhere. So it's completely invaluable, that information, but it's not easy to sell or monetize. Yep. So if I understand you correctly, it's sort of, even if you've done all these prototype things, unless you actually go to market, you don't know for sure what's going to happen. Is that sort of your question? Yeah. And that's exactly true. Does anyone remember New Koogh in the sort of early 90s? Steve does. Good. New Koogh was a... So here's what happened. Pepsi came along and sort of Koogh's market share, Coca-Cola's market share started to... sort of erode, not drop dramatically, but it was sort of constantly eroding, and they figured we need to do something. So they spent an inordinate amount of money on user research to perfect their Coca-Cola recipe. Millions and millions of dollars on the user research. And then they spent like tens of millions, I'm sure, on marketing and campaigns and everything. There's a new, like, this was the first time they were going to change the tried and tested sort of Koogh recipe. Massive worldwide launch, and everybody hated it. Because it turns out it was just too sweet. Which is really nice if you take one sip in a user-controlled setting. Where you go, like, which of these six do you like? I mean, you got to sip from there and a sip from there, and that one is the best one. But if you had to drink a can of this stuff, oh no. Right. So until you actually go to market, you don't know anything for sure. Right. So there's definitely a lot of that. But that doesn't mean you can't get any information from your user research. Right? You can get very valid information from it. But yeah, you don't know for sure until you actually go, it's on the shelves, or whatever the equivalent is for your product. And people can actually spend their hard-earned cash on it. They can say they want to buy this stuff, but until you actually say, well, that's fine, can I please have your credit card? That's where it's the rubber meets the road, right? That's where it gets interesting. Damn it! Someone said MVP. So how much time do I have? 6 minutes. Let's do a quick 6 minute MVP rant. The first thing I want to get out of people's mind is there's no such thing as the MVP. Yeah? The MVP is what I always call the crappiest thing we can get away with. Does that ring a bell with people? Yeah. Don't do what MVPs are ways that we can learn, things that we can experiment with. So what we had was, like, we had 20, 30 MVPs. Yeah. Our first paper prototype was an MVP. Now here's a quick model I want to draw. Who here knows of the Kano model? Does anyone know about the Kano model? There's a couple of PSTs there to do. That's good to know. So these. See, that one works better. So Kano was a Japanese researcher. What he was trying to do, he was trying to group product features in different categories. And what he did, he plotted them on an axis, on a sort of a quadrant, where sort of the left here is, we've got none of those. Yeah, we've got none of this feature. And here is if we have all of them, if everything. This is how sort of unhappy your users are, and this is how happy your users are. And what he found out is that there's three types of categories. The first one he called basic needs. And basic needs, if we don't have basic needs, I'm very unhappy. If I don't have basic needs, I'm very unhappy. If I have the best basic needs, I don't really give a shit. It's fine, right? So the car analogy is brakes. Yeah, if I have no brakes on my car, I'm unhappy. If I have the best brakes in the world, I don't know. As long as they're good enough, that's good enough. It's fine. The next one is performance needs, about performance features. And what they are is the more of these I have, the happier I am. The more I've got none of them, I'm unhappy. If I've got lots of them, I'm very happy. Right? Horsepower. The more horsepower in my car, the happier I am. If I've got none, I'm good. If I've got lots of horsepower, I'm happy. And the other one is what we call delighters. Now, what delighters are things that people don't know they want. Like, if I've got none of them, I'm not unhappy. I don't. So, for example, years ago, there would have been cruise control on a car. Yeah. Especially sort of North America or Australia, where I'm from, where we sort of drive lots of big distances and can actually move. Cruise control is this sort of, but I didn't know I wanted it. But when someone said, would you like we've got cruise control, and everyone was like, this is amazing. Yeah. But there you can also see the other thing, is these delighters quickly become basic needs or performance criteria, right? Would I buy a car without cruise control these days? No, I would. No one ships a car without cruise control anymore. It's just part of those sort of basic needs. So now we have auto park, or line assist, so now we have different features. Now, what happens if you do the MVPing that I see in lots of organizations right now? If you do that MVPing, you go, well, what do we have to do? Well, what we have to do is make sure that we have the basic needs up to a reasonable level. So our basic needs are here. And we need enough sort of the performance thing that users will actually sort of go like, this is okay. Sort of performance needs in difference. Is what you get. People do not care about your product. They don't care because it has all the basic stuff, it's got some of these performance things, but it's got none of these delighters, because these delighters are hard. We don't know whether we're actually going to happen. We don't know. The feature I was talking about, the parental control feature, we didn't even know they wanted it. We accidentally stumbled on a feature that was a delighter to a lot of these people. We weren't even trying to figure out whether that was a delighter or not. So these are tough. These are hard. These are uncertain. But if you want to use MVPs, what MVPs are really meant to be is finding delighters. This is where you should use your MVPs. And the thing is, even if you have crappy MVPs, even if you do MVPs, you cannot have crappy MVPs. If you build a crappy MVP, you will never know whether your users aren't buying it because it's crappy or because they're not interested in that delighter. So you cannot ship crappy MVPs. So the thing to do is, how do we ship less? How do we ship less, right? And that's an interesting question. But what we ship has to be good, it has to be high quality, otherwise we have no information on sort of what it is and isn't. You cannot ship and expect people to buy crappy products, even if it might or might not have some of these letters. Yep. Thank you very much. Greatly appreciate it. I'll be around if we want to have some more chats.